Tarun, I have to say now itself or at the end of the presentation of the sir?
No, now only we are live, you can start.
Okay, so just a second. I have to say DigiNow wala thing before the presentation of the sir, right?
No, actually DigiNow will start after the sir, but we are promoting DigiNow as a part of our SMR. Just I will play the DigiNow PPT before SAR's presentation. That's it. And again, after SAR's presentation, DigiNow people from head office will take the session. So please start, we are live.
Okay. Okay. So yeah, I will be starting in a minute. Okay, so warm greetings to respected dignitaries, organizers, all the delegates, and one and all who have assembled over here for this session. I am Shreya Sarwani, part of organizing committee of MET Invite 2021, will be moderating today's session. Heartiest welcome to the second day of MET Invite 2021. It gives me immense pleasure to share with you all that Squared Medicine and Research, in association with JP, our educational partner, along with DigiNow, proudly presents continuing medical education series with eminent authors at MET Invite 2021 conference. So just a brief presentation of the DigiNow. So yeah, DigiNow is a JP initiative. Who are we? So DigiNow is an EdTech initiative by JP Brothers Medical Publications Prevention Limited. DigiNow aims to provide high quality content to improve concept building, acquire clinical skills, and crack exams by top class faculties, accessible anytime and anywhere. Next slide, please. So yeah, what are JP Brothers? So it started in 1969. The JP Brothers Medical Publications is South Asia's fastest growing and largest medical publishers. JP Brothers is every doctor's first aid. Tarun? So yeah, what we offer, you can see in the screen.
Yeah,
so yeah, JP
now.
Brothers.
Like, series of courses yeah. We talk.
Tarun and team, sorry, Venugopal this side. Tarun and team, let's have a medicine now lecture class. And after this, I will present this and I'll go into detail. Is that fine?
Okay.
Yeah, works. So yeah, because, for the presentation.
Already it is time up. I think let's start this. The session.
Sure. So further, yeah. It will be continued by our JP Publications team at the end of the session. So without a further ado, we will come on to the session now. So yeah, heartiest welcome to the second day of MET Invite 2021. It gives me immense pleasure to share with you all that Squared Medicine and Research, in association with JP Publications, that is our educational partner, proudly presents continuing medical education series with eminent authors at MET Invite 2021 conference. So we are commencing this series today and it will be continued forward throughout the next week, every day from 3 to 4 p.m. Indian Standard Time. Starting with today's session under the series entitled as Electrocardiography, that is ECG, in myocardial infarction by our esteemed speaker of the day, Dr. Arichit Buller, sir. So a little bit about sir. Dr. Arichit Buller, sir, currently is serving at position of additional professor in Department of Medicine at Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore, which is located in Karnataka, India. He has completed his MBBS and MD General Medicine from Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore, Karnataka, India. Coming on to his contribution in the field of research. So Dr. Arichit Buller, sir, has been very proactive in the field of research. Here is the glimpse of scene. So he has been guiding many students for ICMR STS projects, thus shaping young minds by helping them in all aspects of research. He has 12 research publications in reputed national journals. He has also 18 publications in reputed international journals like Lancet, Journal of American Cardiology, NatMed, American Journal of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, and the list of the journal continues. So he has authored 7 books for medical students, some of which are Exam Preparatory Manual for Undergraduate Medicine, Mastering Medicine, MRCP Made Easy, and Insider's Guide to Clinical Medicine. This book, Indian publishers, in October 2020, under the category of scientific, technical, and medical books. Coming on to his achievements and honors. So Dr. Arichit Bulla sir has been honored by different awards. Some of them are, he has received Good Teacher Award in the year of 2015, 2016, 2017, and 2020. He has been awarded for the contribution to the medical literature in the year of 2017, 2019, and 2020. He has also been awarded the Best Audiovisual Aid Award in the year of 2017, 2018, 2019, and still the list goes on of his achievements and honors. Last but not least, Dr. Arichit Bulla sir has also organized innumerable number of CME, that is continuing medical education, webinars and workshops and conferences, etc. Respected sir, it is our honor and privilege to have you over here, and we all are delighted to learn from you. Before handing it over to sir, a quick note for all our delegates that you can type in your questions in YouTube live chat box or Zoom chat box, and they will be addressed during the end of the session. Also, post-event link will be posted in the chat box that is separate for the CME and also in the description of the YouTube live chat. At the end of the session, make sure you fill the same to get eligible for certificates. Handing it over to you, sir, now.
Thank you. So, welcome to this webinar today and the session that I'll be taking about is on ECG in MI. So, the first session, I think, in this webinar series that's going on, and I'll be discussing about a very, very important topic that's of importance both to practicing physicians, to undergraduates, to postgraduates, and all of us here, is the ECG in MI. So right from its invention or discovery in early 1900s, so ECG has been the very, very simple investigation that's available practically everywhere. And though of late, maybe with the newer investigations that have come, the importance to ECG in diagnosis of diseases possibly has reduced a little, but still ECG becomes the most important investigation that is of great importance, especially in the setting of MI that's there. So all of us know about acute coronary syndrome. So acute coronary syndrome, which encompasses unstable angina, the non-ST elevation MI, and the ST elevation MI. Basic categorization is based on the ECG changes that we look at, as well as the cardiac enzyme. So ECG becomes a very important thing when we diagnose acute coronary syndrome itself, which is an emergency that is encountered day in and day out. Now, if you see the entire process of the pathophysiology of ischemic heart disease, the myocardial ischemia, the myocardial injury, and the infarction have different changes that would occur on an ECG, and each of them can be identified easily on an ECG. So if you see the central zone that's there here, you can see the zone of infarction, followed by the zone of injury, and then the zone of ischemia that's there. Each of them would have specific changes that would occur on an ECG, and that is important for us to note. So if you say ischemia that's happening, the change that is very importantly seen of a ischemia is the flip T waves or the T wave inversion that we see, followed by the ST depression And sometimes you can find the flipped T waves. So the major changes that we see, this is the normal T waves. You can see at the bottom here. And here you have the T wave inversions, which are symmetrical. Please remember, what do you mean by symmetrical T wave inversions? If you see the entire causes, list of causes of T wave inversions, anything under the sun, including the sun, can produce a T wave inversion, they say. So you have hundreds of causes of T wave inversions. But the ischemic T wave is a symmetrical T wave inversion. That means the point where it goes down and the point where it comes up and reaches the baseline is absolutely the same there. So that's the what we mean by symmetric. If you draw a line there, you'll get it exactly at that point. So symmetrical T wave inversions are the sign of ischemia. Even ST depressions are signs of ischemia. So if you find these on an ECG, we call it as ischemic changes. These changes are respective of ischemia. Coming on to injury. Now, injury on an ECG is represented by ST elevation and peak T waves. Please remember, these are the early changes when you have an acute MI. The injury is the first thing that happens there. And that's why you get the tall peak T waves and the ST segment elevations. Once the MI has evolved and the infarct has actually happened, the change down ECG is represented of infarct is the Q waves. So, you know, the significant Q waves, when the Q waves height should be at least 25% of the neighboring R wave, or the width should be at least a box in width that's there. So significant Q waves. So if in an ECG, we see Q waves, it is suggestive of infarct. So we have ischemia, we have injury and infarct. So each of them have specific changes that are noted on an ECG. So when we see the changes that happen in a sequential wave, the first change to happen is the tall T waves. So you can see that the T waves are the first change, what we call it as an hyperacute stage, followed by the ST elevation. And after the ST elevation, it comes down and settles. The T wave starts becoming inverted. And after 24 hours onwards, the Q waves would come. And remember, the ECG becomes normal except for the Q wave. Q wave is like memory. Q wave remains forever. Q wave is the memory of this infarction that would have occurred. So that's the sequential changes. As I told you, the first is the tall T wave that's going to happen, followed by the ST segment elevation. Then the ST segment comes down, the T inverts, and finally the Q waves would appear. So each of them have various pathophysiological, why each of them is happening. I won't go into the details because my basic purpose of this session is to give the importance of ECG in recognizing the MI, as well as the various types of MI and the complications of MI. So I won't go into the biophysics of why these changes are happening. Now, if you see the ST segment elevation, so from the baseline, we are going to calculate the ST segment elevation and we are going to say whether it is 2 millimeters, 3 millimeters, etc. The Q waves, again, we are going to measure the height of the Q wave, compare it with the neighboring S wave or the R wave that is there, and based on that, we say whether it is significant or not. T waves, always, I told you, you have to look for symmetry of the T wave, because symmetrical T wave inversions is suggestive of ischemia. Asymmetrical T waves could be seen in many other conditions that could be there. So again, just briefing about what happens first. So the T wave, which becomes very tall, remember the criteria for tall T wave, it's 2/3 of the neighboring QRS, followed by the ST elevations, various patterns of ST elevations you do get. Then the ST segment would come down, the T wave would start inverting, and then the Q wave would form. So the Q wave would form after 12 hours. So when won't you see a Q wave on an MI ECG? It is an evolved MI. That is what we would say. So there are other terms that are used. If you just find hyperacute T waves, we call it as an hyperacute phase. The ST elevation with the T waves being tall. Just remember, T waves still upright and the ST elevation. This is called as an early acute phase. The ST elevation is there, but the T wave has started becoming inverted. This is called as a late acute phase. And then the ST segment now starts coming down. The Q waves start appearing. That is the fully evolved phase, 12 hours, fully evolved phase. And then everything else is normalized. Only the Q wave is persisting. That is the healed phase of MI. So you have the hyperacute, early acute, late acute, the fully evolved phase, and the healed phases. This would be the various sequential changes. A very common theory question that they ask you about MI, the sequential changes. and you get a large number of MCQs that are there based on each of these changes. So what is the recommendation when we say to call it as an ST segment elevation? So the recommendation states that at least in the leads that are there, V2 and V3, you should have a 2 millimeters elevation. And in other leads, 1 millimeter elevation of ST segment is significant. So lesser than that may not be fitting into the criteria of ST segment elevation. So this is the recommendation that we have. V2 and V3, we should have an elevation of at least 2 millimeters to call it significant. The next thing that you have to remember is if there is people who are younger age, 40 years and younger than that, especially in men, say the abnormal values, you should say that it should be at least 2.5 millimeters in the V2 and V3. So you have to remember V2 and V3, they are the anterior leads that are there. You can have some amount of a J-point elevation, which can be normal. So anything more than 2.5 is definitely abnormal that we can see. So in women, the threshold of J-point elevation in V2, V3 is considered as 1.5 for women. Okay, so men have a higher cutoff that is to be considered. Always remember, when you have a change which is happening in one part of the heart, the exactly opposite leads will show the inverted changes. Supposedly you have a ST segment elevation occurring in one lead that's there. If supposedly you have an anterior lead, V1 to V6, you might get ST elevations there. But in inferior leads, you will find ST segment depression and T wave inversion. This is called as reciprocal changes. That's because of the negative of the current. So whatever is located opposite to that, you would get a negative deflection. So these are called as reciprocal changes. But please remember, in the absence of an ST segment elevation, ST segment depression and T wave inversion is considered as ischemia. So these ST segment depressions and T wave inversions are considered as ischemia, provided there is no ST segment elevation in any other leads. So to call as reciprocal changes, you should have actually acute changes in some other leads. Only then can you call that. Now, why do we have to localize the MI? So very importantly, we have to know the localization of MI, whether it's an anterior wall, whether it's an inferior wall, whether it's a lateral wall MI, or is it a combination? Why? It's very important because it decides the culprit artery, the blood vessel. Even before we do an angio, we know that this is the vessel. And we have to decide the further management. Now, it's important to understand that inferior wall MIs by far are the most common MIs that you would encounter. Inferior wall MIs are associated with one set of complications, usually bradycardia, hypotension, the heart blocks are associated with inferior wall. When you see the anterior wall MI, that takes the entire left ventricle, majority of the chunk might get affected. So they come with pulmonary edema. They come with ventricular tachycardia. So there is a different set of complications that can be there in them. The inferior wall MIs, generally the hypotension, the left ventricle is normal. So they respond very well to fluids. If you give fluids, only then the BP will improve if it's an inferior wall or a right ventricular MI. Fluids are needed in such cases. But if you give IV fluids for a patient with anterior wall MI, you will push them into pulmonary edema. So the treatment for one can calm the other MI. The complications of one may not be seen in the other. So we have to be aware of these. And the drugs that we use, supposedly the acute management, the beta blockers, etc., or the nitrates, are relatively contraindicated in inferior wall MI because the blood pressure can further drop, the bradycardia can worsen. So we have to know these complications. Only then can we plan our management. So that is the importance of localization of MI. So if you see the right coronary artery, which supplies the right ventricle, predominantly the SA node and the AV node, severe hypotension can occur and you get the bradyarrhythmias that could be there if the right coronary artery is involved. Also, rarely you could have the papillary muscle rupture producing the mitral regurgitation that can occur with right coronary artery. In contrast, if you have the left anterior descending getting blocked, remember the 40% of the LV myocardium is supplied by that. So the patient can be in a cardiogenic shock. You could get a VST that could be there. You could get an aneurysm that can happen and which can cause arrhythmias, it can cause thrombus, and you can get the left bundle branch block in the LAD influx that could be there. So the complication pattern is different with both the vessels that are involved. So if you see the, in brief, I'll be discussing about the anatomy of the arch. So you have the anterior part of the heart, when we say an anterior MI, the basic parts which come anteriorly is the right atrium, right ventricle there, the LV part of the LV and the LA. The left predominantly is the LV that we are talking about. The inferior or the diaphragmatic surface, 2/3 is the left ventricle and 1/3 is by the right ventricle. And the posterior predominantly is the LA, a small portion of the RA, the IVC, SVC and the pulmonary vein. So these are the surfaces of the heart anatomically. The blood supply goes along with that. So these are the waves I've set. So this is the anterior portion of the heart. This is the inferior and this is the lateral. And the posterior one is behind that. So you can see the posterior one in the next image, which I'll be showing. That's the posterior, which predominantly contains the LA, the RA and the IVC, SVC and the pulmonary veins. So the infarctions get involved with these. We call them as anterior infarction, inferior infarction, a lateral infarction or a true posterior infarction. That's the nomenclature that we use. Briefly about the blood supply, you have the major vessels that you have, the left coronary artery and the right coronary artery. The left coronary artery has two major branches that we see, the left circumflex and the left anterior descending. So this is the circumflex, this is the descending, and this is the right coronary artery which supplies. So if you see the anatomical orientation, you know the supply of the blood vessels is particular regions that are there. So each of them will have different. So the right coronary artery is a very small artery, predominantly supplies the right atrium there, right ventricle, the posterior part of the interventricular septum. So that's the predominant part. And a small area of the left ventricle is supplied by the right coronary artery. You do get a large number of MCQs based on this coronary blood supply. That's why you have to know this. In contrast, if you see the left coronary artery, it predominantly the entire left ventricle is supplied by that. A small portion of the right ventricle and the bundle branch, the left bundle branch is supplied by that. Please remember the entire conducting system, except a small portion of the left bundle, is supplied by RCA. So conduction problems are more with right coronary artery supplied, except for LVVV, which occurs with left coronary artery, which is getting supplied. So this blood supply is also important for us. So the same thing, I'm telling you the individual branches. We'll be discussing each of them once we see the ECGs of each of the MI. So based on the portion of the ventricles or the heart that is supplied by the particular branch, the changes will be seen. So if you can remember this, it's very good. Otherwise, maybe we'll have to use certain algorithms to make out the individual branches and the supply. So as all of you know, the leads of the heart are classified into inferior leads, the lateral leads, the anterior leads, the septal leads. So the 2, 3 and AVF, lead 2, 3 and AVF are called as the inferior leads. The 1 AVL, V5, V6 are called as a lateral lead. V5, V6 are called as bilateral leads. V1 and V2 are called as septal leads, whereas V3, V4 are called as anterior leads. We have to remember this because the MI, we are calling as inferior wall MI. If it is 2, 3 AVF, we get ST elevations. We call it as a lateral MI if you get 1 AVL, V5, V6. So the nomenclature is based on the vascular territory and the leads which look at the heart from different sides. So this is how a normal 12-lead ECG would look like. So if you have changes that occur in 2, 3 and AVF, that's the inferior wall that we are taking. 2, 3 and AVF is inferior wall. If you're seeing the V1, V2 and up to V4, V5, V6, that's V5 there. So V1, V2 is the septal. The V3, V4 is predominantly the anterior. Generally, they become together. So that's the anterior leads. 1, AVL, V5 and V6, these are the lateral leads. 1 AVL, V5, V6 is the lateral leads. AVR is the, what we call it as an orphan lead. It looks at the heart from inside. So it's looking from the cavity of the heart. You do have a lot of relevance of AVR lead in MI. We'll be discussing it in the future slides. So if you see, if the left main coronary artery gets occluded, all the branches of that would get occluded. So that will have an extensive injury that would have. If you have a left circumflex that is getting affected, usually has a lateral and an inferior part. LAD, if it is getting blocked, you get an anteroseptal injury. So left main coronary artery occlusion is the most lethal of all the occlusions that you could have. Now, if you have the right coronary artery that is getting involved, predominantly the inferior wall and the right ventricle and the posterior wall that is getting involved. So if you remember, the simple mnemonic that's there, the left coronary artery, septal, anterior, lateral, and very rarely inferior. Okay, left coronary artery, that's the left circumflex post, which goes part of that. The right coronary artery predominantly causes RV infarct, inferior infarct, and posterior infarct, RIP. Please remember the inferior infarcts are by far the most common infarcts that you do encounter. The conduction system, as I've already told you, please remember this. It's important for us because majority of the conduction system is supplied by the right coronary artery. So be the SA node, be the AV node, be the bundle of His, the right bundle, only a small portion of the left bundle is supplied by the left coronary artery. That's what we have to remember. Based on the prevalence, the right coronary artery and the left circumflex together contribute to around 57% of the MIs that are seen. Both of them generally produce the inferior wall MI. LCX alone can produce the lateral, but RCA and LCX both produce the inferior wall MI. LAD is seen in almost around 35% of people, and that produces the anterior MI that is there. So inferior MI is the most common, followed by the anterior, and the rest of them could be in combination that could be there. So let's go on to the main core of today's session, is how do you localize the particular artery based on the ECG that is given to you. Once you identified its MI, how do you say this is which type of MI and how do you say which artery that is involved? So that's the basic part of today's session. So coming on to the first MI that we are going to discuss is the anterior wall myocardial infarction. So the anterior MI, we've already discussed. The vessel that we are going to look for is the left anterior descending artery. And it has one of the worst prognosis compared to inferior wall MI. So what do you look for? You look for ST elevations and Q waves in V1 to V4 leads or a V5, V6. And reciprocal changes in inferior leads. 2-3 AV will have ST segment depressions and T wave inversions. That's how we diagnose an anterior wall MI. So it's very important to know the site of occlusion of the left coronary artery. Is it proximal? Is it mid? Or is it in the distal part? Because the complications that are ensuing will change with each of them. And even if there is a left main coronary artery occlusion, the best of the centers, possibly the chances of mortality remains high. So it's very important for us to localize it, whether it is an stem of MCA, that's a stem of LAD that's getting affected there and followed by the branches. So ECG helps us a lot in that. So that is what we have to see. So this is how a anterior infarction would look like. You can see that there is ST segment elevation in V1, V2, V3, V4, up to V5 you're seeing, and you're finding ST segment depression in 2, 3 and AVF that you're seeing. So this is the classical picture that you could say. Always remember, the ST segment elevation is best represented in V2 or V3 of the chest leads. V2 or V3 is the one where you get the best ST segment elevation. So this is the descending order. If you see, V2 is more than V3, followed by V4, V5, and AVL, V1, and then V6. So that's the ST elevation will be in which. So V2 is the most sensitive to identify the culprit vessel, because based on that, we have the criteria. I'll be coming to that in the future. Now, it's very important for us to understand that if you compare anterior wall MI versus inferior wall MI, though inferior wall MI is the commonest MI that we are seeing, the in-hospital mortality, the total mortality, the heart failure chances, the chances of arrhythmias, all are high with the anterior wall MI that's there compared to inferior wall MI. So the acute mortality as well as the complications are much higher with anterior wall MI. That's why we have to be of care. So as I've discussed it already, septal leads are V1 and V2. Anterior leads is V2 to V5 that we are saying there. The lateral leads are V5, V6 that's there. So you can have a combination of them. You can say anteroseptal if you have changes in V1 to V3. Anterolateral, one AVL is also showing. And if all the leads are showing, we call it as an extensive anterior or an anterolateral MI. Now this is the anatomic of the left coronary artery. You have the left anterior descending that's given there. And then you have the diagonal branches and the septal branches that could be there. So this is the LAD here, the distal LAD. This is before the diagonal branch 1, the diagonal branch 2, and then the septal branches are there. This will be the main stem of the left coronary artery that will be there. LCX is given in the side there. So let's go on to the first site that could be there. The first site is proximal occlusion. So occlusion proximal to the first septal branch. That's the first occlusion site that could be there. So what is important to identify is there will be changes of anterior wall MI, plus there will be ST segment elevation in AVR. Please remember this, AVR, that's the basal portion of the septum gets infected. So the AVR, which is seeing the heart from inside, you get ST segment elevation. So it's a very pathognomonic sign there. It means it's a very proximal occlusion of the vessel. ST elevation in V1 will be very prominent, more than 2.5 millimeters. You may get a complete RV. So complete RVV is always a proximal occlusion. Please remember these three, because a very common MCQs are asked what indicates a proximal occlusion. 1, 2, 3, ST segment elevation in AVR, ST elevation in V1, more than 2.5, and a complete RVVP, all are signs of a proximal occlusion of the vessel that is there. You might get ST depressions in the inferior leads that can be seen in other anterior MIs also. So if you see the CCG here, we are talking about the anterior wall MI. So in anterior wall MI, you find ST segment elevations. You can see that you're finding ST segment elevation in V1, V2, V3, V4, V5. So it's an extensive MI that you're seeing, extensive MI. You're finding ST segment depression in lead 2, lead 3 and AVF. So inferior leads are also showing you reciprocal changes. Now, once you have made the diagnosis of ST segment elevation anterior wall MI, is it a proximal occlusion? So the important thing, please look at the right bundle branch. So moment you have an RBBB, you know it's a proximal occlusion. Okay. And if you have an ST segment elevation in V1, which is more than 2.5 centimeters from the baseline, this is the baseline here, that would suggest a proximal. And you see very carefully the AVR. AVR, you're finding the ST segment elevation. So if this is there, this means a proximal occlusion. The entire LV myocardium could get involved. So you can get lateral ischemia also in this. The complications are much higher. So ST segment elevation in AVR is a very, very sensitive sign. And it's a very specific sign for proximal LAD occlusion. RBBB, as I've told you, is an important thing. If you see, it is also suggestive of poor prognosis. So the next site after the proximal is below the first septal and the first diagonal. First diagonal is given, the first septal is there. So how do you diagnose it there if it is there? So here, basically, ST segment is not elevated in the one AVL or AVR. So AVR, the septum, basal portion, the blood supply is gone. The left circumflex is already gone off there. So the lateral leads are also spared. So ST segment elevation will not be there in one AVL and AVR. And there will not be ST segment depression in 2-3 AVL. But you'll have only ST segment elevations in V1 to V4. So that is what would say it is between these two sites. So you will have, in contrast, ST segment elevation in 2-3 AVL. In contrast to the reciprocal changes, we will have ST segment elevation in 2-3 AVF. I'll just show it to you in the image. So if we find an anterior wall MI, you're seeing that in V1 to V4, you're finding ST segment elevation here. And if you see ST segment depression in 2-3 AVF, that means it's a proximal occlusion. But if you find ST segment elevation in 2-3 AVF, that would indicate a distal occlusion. It's not a proximal occlusion. So this is the algorithm that has been given. I think this is from the NEJM. So whenever you find an anterior wall MI, you know it's a LAD occlusion. Look for 2-3 AVF. If you find ST segment depression in 2-3 AVF, it's a very proximal LAD occlusion. If you find an ST segment elevation in 2-3 AVF, it's a distal occlusion. So you look at the inferior leads. If you find elevation, that's a proximal occlusion. And if it is elevation you're finding, that means there is a distal occlusion. Along with that, I've told you the two other features, the AVR ST segment elevation and a new onset RBBB will always indicate it's the most proximal to the V1. So here, if you see that there is an anterior wall MI, you can see that there is an ST segment elevation in anterior leads, V1, V2, V3, V4, you're finding that there is ST segment in inferior leads. You see 2, 3 and AVF, you're finding ST segment depressions that you're seeing. Carefully look at AVR, you're finding that there is an ST segment elevation in AVR. There's no bundle branch block. So this is not a distal occlusion, this is a proximal occlusion. So if you can remember this much, whether it's a distal or proximal, the complication rates are much more in a proximal occlusion MI that could be there. So this is again the predictive value of the various changes that I have told you. So if you have an ST segment elevation in V1 and an RBBB pattern that's there, it has 100% positive predictive value and a specific predictive value for a proximal LAD. So that's the specificity. If you find that there is an RBBB that is there. So that is the importance of us knowing the other changes in the other leads that we have to see. So again, see the CCG here very clearly. You're finding ST segment elevation in the anterior leads. Along with that, look at the inferior leads. You're finding 2, 3 and AVF. You're finding ST segment depression. So is it proximal or distal? It is proximal. It is a proximal LAD. Along with that, you're finding RBBB. So it's a proximal LAD. Look at AVR. If there is an ST segment elevation in AVR, this would indicate a proximal LAD occlusion. Here, you're finding an anterior wall MI. You're finding that there is ST segment elevation in V1, V2, V3, V4. You're finding an ST segment elevation. Now look at the inferior leads. The inferior leads here, 2, 3 and AVF. What are you finding? You're finding ST segment elevation. You expected ST segment, finding ST segment elevation. So this is an anterior wall MI, but it's a distal LAD occlusion of. So that's how you differentiate whether it's a proximal or distal. Now this, there is one more entity, what we call it as a wraparound LAD. This is what produces the ST segment elevation in the inferior leads. The LAD is larger and longer and it goes to the undersurface that is there. And there it causes, whenever that part of the segment gets occluded, you get both anterior and inferior changes together, what we saw in the early ACG. So that's what we call it as a wraparound left anterior descending. So here you have an ECG, very, you're seeing here, you're finding very gross ST segment elevation. So see this, V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, even in AVL you're finding and 1 you're finding. So it's an extensive anterolateral MI that you're seeing here. You're finding ST segment depressions in the inferior leads there. This pattern is called as a tombstoning pattern. It looks like tombstones. So this is a proximal LAD occlusion and it has a very high mortality. This tombstoning pattern has a very, very high mortality that's there. These patients present with poor LV ejection fraction and generally they have cardiogenic shock and death. So it is this is what we call it as a widow maker. That is the tombstoning pattern when we see on ECG. It's very, very high chance of mortality that you have. So this is a summary of the LAD occlusion, as I told you. ST segment elevation in AVR, acquired RBBB, ST depressions in 2-3 AVF, it's proximal. If you have distal LAD, you find that absent ST depressions and presence of ST segment elevation in this inferior leads. So that's how you localize the anterior wall MI. I will go on to these a little later if time permits the MCQs. We will go on to the rest of it, part of it. So we have discussed about the anterior wall MI, which part of the vessel that is supplied. We have the other two types of MI that is there. By far the most common, as I told you, is the inferior wall MI. So that's the most common because that is this part of the vessel that's there. This is the anterior septal and this is the posterior wall that's there. And this is the blood supply. Each of the branches would supply the each important part. The right coronary artery with its branches predominantly supplies this part there. You can see the left circumflex also, which is given from the LAD. It turns around like this and then supplies the inferior and posterior wall that is there. So both the right coronary artery and the left circumflex predominantly supply the inferior wall. The left circumflex additionally will supply the lateral wall. So when we talk about lateral wall MI, we're talking about the LCX alone. When we're talking about inferior wall MI, we're talking about the RCA as well as LCX. One important vessel is the left main coronary artery, LMCA. Again, the highest mortality if you see is LMCA occlusion. that is before the LAD and the LCS is given, just at the root of the aorta, that's when the branch is arising. That's the left main coronary artery originating. So these are the various vessels and that can how it can. So how do you identify this left main coronary artery stenosis? So it will have all the features of your both LCX as well as the LAD is getting. So you'll have both the MIs together in that. What you have to see is the ST segment elevation in AVR or V1. Now I told you the proximal LAD, both V1 and AVR will have ST segment elevation. Now you just have to compare the ST segment elevation of AVR and V1. If the AVR ST segment elevation is more than V1, that indicates the left main coronary artery stenosis. So again, we'll have a widespread ST segment elevation or ST segment depression that will be there. So this is a very important thing that you have to remember is AVR. Let's take an ECG and take the example for that. And I will show the part. So ST elevation in AVR. Before I go to the ECG, just remember this. They often ask AVR lead is a neglected lead. AVR is a neglected because we say AVR does not have any particular wall. But whenever you see an ST segment elevation in AVR, it indicates a left main coronary or a proximal LAD. If it is more than 1 millimeters, this is an indicator of a coronary artery procedure. You have to do that. And if it AVR elevation is more than V1, it indicates left main coronary artery that is there. And absence of ST elevation in AVR almost entirely excludes the left main coronary artery lesions that is there. Also, please remember this, the more the higher the ST segment elevation in AVR, you can see that 0.5 millimeters, fourfold mortality, 1 millimeter, 6 to 7-fold mortality, and more than 1.5 millimeter ST segment elevation in AVR, the mortality goes as high as 75%. So, AVR has a very, very important role, especially the ST segment elevation in AVR in a patient with MI. So this is what I was talking about. So it's an anterior wall MI ECG I'm showing you. So you're finding that the ST segment elevation here in V1 and the ST segment elevation in AVR. So you have to compare it now, which is higher than the other. If AVR is more than the ST segment elevation in V1, it means the left main coronary artery lesion. Both belong to the anterior wall MI itself. One more thing that you, one more pattern that was described by D. Winters is the classical T waves in V2 to V3 during the chest pain free period. The patient comes with chest pain decreases, and then you find the classical T wave inversion, which you're seeing. I'll show you the image of that. That's called as a Wellen syndrome. So you find this classical T wave inversions that are there in the mid precordial leads, V2, V3. In the intermittent time when there is no chest pain. So again, that's a very important marker of an ischemia that is ongoing. So that also has to be remembered. So not only during the pain, in between the pain also you would have this changes that could happen. The other thing that you'd remember, one more named wave, a lot of MCQs are asked on this. This is what we call it as a D. Winters T wave, anterior STMI. It means an anterior STMI. There's no ST elevation, but you get ST depression with peaked T waves in the precordial. So it means that it is acute LAD occlusion, which is seen, which was a recent, almost in 2008, it was described. Till then, ST segment depression was never considered as part of MI. It was called as ischemia only. But with ST segment depression and peaked T waves together, that became acute LAD occlusions that we call it as D. Winters T waves. Usually seen in young males, and it has a high predictive for LAD occlusion. So this is the classical D. Winters T waves you're seeing there. You can see that there is an ST segment depression here, and then there is a T wave that you're seeing there. So you could consider this as an ischemia, but actually this is an acute LAD occlusion. So instead of ST segment elevation, you're just finding the T waves that are prominent that's there. But if you carefully look at it, you can see that there is an ST segment elevation in V1, and then there is an ST segment elevation in AVR, and the AVR ST segment elevation is more than V1. So this is a left main coronary artery occlusion. So it may not show the other ST segment elevations in the anterior leads. In place of that, there is prominent T waves and ST segment depression. This is what we call it as the D. Winters sign. So also, it's a feature of an anterior wall MI. Coming on to inferior wall MI, I said by far the most common MI that we have is inferior wall MI. So it accounts to more than 50%, and it has a better prognosis compared to anterior wall MI, and it's associated with high right ventricular MI. So patient can come with severe hypotension, and these patients, by chance you give them nitrates, the BP will worsen. How much ever inotropes you give, how much of an adrenaline you give, the BP will not improve unless we give fluids. So this right ventricular infarction responds to IV fluids. So we have to diagnose that. And then we'll have to. Also importantly, the right coronary artery supplies the AV node, SA node. So the heart blocks are more common with them. And the posterior infections are also more common with them. So we'll discuss in the inferior wall MI, how do we localize these? So which leads you look for inferior wall MI? 2, 3 and AVF. So please remember 2, 3 AVF is inferior wall MI. So all three arteries can get involved and you can get the inferior wall MI. So right coronary artery, LCX, and rarely as we discussed the wraparound LAD. So 80% of the time is the right coronary artery because that's a dominant artery. 18% of the time is the dominant LCX, and the rare type, that is the wraparound, which I told you, the LAD comes down and comes down. So it will be associated with the anterior wall. So how do you make out? So look for the 2-3 AVF. If you find 3 more than 2, if the ST segment elevation in lead 3 is more than lead 2, that means it is in right coronary artery. So right coronary artery, RCA, is the 3-letter word that's there. RCA stands 3 words. That's how you remember it. So 3 more than 2 is RCA. RCA. Whereas LCX is only 2. If the 2 ST elevation is more than 3, that means it is LCA. So simple way to make out that. So let's see the example for that. I'll show you the ECG that, and then we can see here. So now here we have a ECG of a ST segment elevation MI in the inferior wall. You can see that ST segment elevation lead 2, lead 3 and AVF. So this is an inferior wall MI. We know it is either RCA or LCX. Compare the ST segment elevation in 3 and 2. Which lead is showing more? Anyone can tell me or put it in the chat box? Is lead elevation in 3 more than 2 or 2 more than 3? Okay, you can make out that it is lead 3 is more elevated than the lead 2. So lead 3 is more elevated than lead 2. So which vessel? It is the right coronary artery. So that's how you localize. Very simple. So RCA more than LCX. So this is RCA territory involvement that you are seeing. Again, you see this is again an inferior wall MI. You're finding that there is an ST segment elevation in lead 2, lead 3, AVF. The rhythm strip that is seeing there. So again, lead 3 is more than the lead 2 elevation that is there. So again, it is a right coronary artery involvement that you can see. So these are all the various changes of inferior wall MI, which I'm showing in this patient. So here, you're finding a ST elevation 2, 3 AVF that is there. The early Q waves that is there. ST in 3 is more than 2. And that's again would suggest a right coronary artery involvement. Bradycardia and AV blocks, very common with inferior wall MI. So heart blocks can occur. Almost 20% of them would get them. And it's basically because of the blood supply, ischemia to the AV node. That's the cause for the heart blocks that is there. Also, sometimes it could be just to what we call it as a Bejol Jarisch reflex. There is a vagal tone that gets activated whenever there is an ischemia. Because of that, there is a vagal activation resulting in bradycardia. You can see that there is an inferior wall MI here. You're finding 2, 3 and AVF, gross ST elevations. You're finding severe bradycardia. Heart rate is very low in this patient. And you see this P waves. You can see the P waves coming on their own. The QRS is going on its own. So atria is going on its own. The ventricle is going on its own. This is the complete heart block that you get in, a third degree heart block that you get in inferior wall MI. So they are prone to heart blocks, and any heart block of Mobitz type 2 or a third degree heart block is can be dangerous, so you will require pacemaker insertion. And once the MI resolves, large number of these heart blocks will resolve. these patients may not need a permanent pacemaker, but temporary pacemaker might be mandatory because the heart rate can drop to around less than 40, as in this patient you can see. As I told you, right ventricular infarction is commonly associated with inferior wall MI, so you will have to look for it. It is subtle and it is easily missed. So how do you make out this RV infarction? So how do you make out it? If you have ST elevation in V1. Because please remember, in the chest, when you place the lead, the right ventricle, the only lead that looks at the right ventricle is V1. So V1, if you find ST segment elevation, that means there is a RV MI. ST elevation in 3 more than 2, that means it's the right coronary artery which is predominantly causing that. And if you see the magnitude of the ST segment elevation exceeds the magnitude of ST segment elevation in V2. Just remember these ST segment elevation in V1, if you find in an inferior wall MI, that would suggest an RV infarction. So that is what you have to remember. Also, if the ST segment in V1 is isoelectric and V2 is markedly depressed. So if you see that V1 is normal, but V2 is gone down, that's also suggested. Or in contrast, V1 is elevated and V2 is depressed. That's a very specific. If you find that ST elevation in V1, but ST is depressed in V2, it's almost specific that it is right ventricular MI. So V1, V2 will give you the clue. But this should be associated with inferior wall MI. Only then can you say that. Now, if you see here, this is an inferior wall MI. You're seeing that there is a ST segment elevation in 2, 3 and AVN. So it's an inferior wall MI. 3 more than 2, so it's a right coronary artery. Again, you're finding that there is some amount of PR prolongation that's there. So there's some sort of a heart block. Now we have to see whether there is a right ventricular infarction. So which lead will you look for? You look for ST segment in V1. Not finding much, okay, slight elevation there. But what you're finding in V2 is a depression. So V2 depression, V1 elevation. This is very specific for right coronary artery. So RCA, these patients require good IV fluids. If you have to suspect and specifically look for, please remember, very common MCT will you take for right-sided MI or IV MI is the V4R. Like what you're placing the V4 normally here, the same V4R, you can place it on the right side and you can take the ECG, you'll find the ST segment elevation. So V4R is one lead that you can take on the opposite side, on the right side you can place, and based on that you can make out. So V4R is the lead that you look for. Same lead is for your dextrocardia also, okay? So just by taking one lead, you can make out a large amount of things. If you see that, V4R can tell you about the right ventricular MI. It can say whether it's an RC or LCX, whether you can say a proximal or distal. So if you see that ST segment elevation in is more than 1 millimeters and you get a positive T wave in V4R, that means it's a proximal right coronary artery occlusion. So proximal right coronary artery. If there is no ST segment elevation, but there is T wave is upright, that would indicate a distal occlusion. Distal occlusion that could be there. But if you have a T wave inversion in the V4R rather than upright T wave, it indicates that it's the left circumflex, not the right coronary artery. So V4R has also relevance. I think sometimes for postgraduates, they ask you about this AVR and V4R in your exam. So you have to know the relevance of these two leads. Not very, very important as generally you can say that. So this is a summary of the inferior wall, but please remember, you're just looking at the ST elevation in lead 2 and 3, and 3 more than 2, it is RCA, 2 more than 3, it is LCX. Whenever there is an RCA, please look at lead V1, V2. If you find that V1 is having ST segment elevation, V2 is having ST segment depression, that is right coronary artery, right ventricular MI, that is there. So that's the predictive values. If you see again, as I've told you, ST segment elevation 3 more than 2 has a predictive value of 90% for the right coronary artery. The last portion of the right coronary artery which can supply is the posterior wall. Now, posterior wall, almost around 15 to 20% of them can have this. It can be there both with inferior as well as lateral. Isolated is very rare. So that's the back of the portion that is there. Now, the true term posterior wall is actually abundant. It's called as an inferior wall because it lies along with that only. So actual word is not there anymore. So how do you identify that? So again, please remember, this is a part of inferior wall FI. So whenever there is an inferior wall FI, again, come on to the V1 to V3. And if you get this pattern, you see this ST segment depression, which is so nicely going down in V1 to V3, you have to suspect posterior wall FI. Posterior is directly back. So if it plays a lead in the back, you'll find ST segment elevation. So it is posterior wall MI in V1 to V3 if you get this ST depression. And the T waves is upright. Very important. T waves is upright, ST segment depressed. So whenever you have an inferior wall MI, look for RVMI, look for posterior wall. That is what you'll have to look for. So actually, if you have to diagnose a posterior wall MI, you'll have to take a lead in the back there. The V7, V8 in the back, if you take, you'll find that the ST segment elevation will be there. This is how it looks from the front. This is how it looks from the back. You don't have to do that. You just find this ST segment, horizontal ST segment depressions and a tall R waves. That's one more thing that you have to remember. Tall R waves in V1, one of the differential diagnoses is posterior wall MI. So again, so here we have an inferior wall MI. See here, there is 2, 3 and AVF. Here you are finding that the 2 is more than 3. You can see that ST elevation in 2 is more than 3. So it's not RCA, it is LCX. Next, you look at the V1, V2. There you can see that V1, V2, V3. You're finding a horizontal ST segment depression and tall T waves, prominent R waves that you're seeing there. So this is posterior wall MI. So this is how the posterior wall MI would look like. So that's the posterior wall MI. Actually, if you take a lead V7, V8, V9 at the back, you find that there is elevations there. You don't have to do this all the time. So this is what we have already discussed. So I won't go on to the detail of that. So you are going to say whether the right coronary artery is associated with inferior wall plus right ventricular plus posterior wall. You'll have to look for this. The last type of MI is the lateral wall MI, which is by the left circumflex branch or some of the LAD branches that is there. The leads you're going to look for is 1AVL, V5, V6. So 1AVL, V5, V6 is the lead. Please look at these leads and you find that there is ST segment elevation in these leads. That would be suggestive of, if you have just in 1 in AVL, we call it as a high lateral. If you find it in all of the leads, we call it as lateral wall MI. Usually can be associated with inferior lateral changes also. So here you're finding that there is an ST segment elevation in 1AVL. So this is a lateral wall MI, high lateral MI. You're finding that there is depression in 3 and AVF, slight into 3. So that's the reciprocal changes that you can see. So that's the serial changes that occur in an ECG when an MI occurs. So please remember the first change is a tall T wave followed by the ST elevation. Then the ST comes down, the T wave inverts, and finally the Q wave, and the Q wave remains forever. That's what you have to remember. So the various localizations help us to narrow down the coronary artery. So anterior wall MI, you know it is LAD, septal is LAD, lateral is LCX, inferior, right coronary artery, posterior is right coronary artery, right ventricular artery is, and the atrial MI, which is rare, is all right coronary artery, that is. So before we wind up, just let's take up a few examples that are there here. So what are you finding in this particular ECG? So these are all MI ECGs only. So basically, we'll have to try to localize the type of MI that you're seeing. So here, you're finding ST segment elevations in the anterior leads. You're finding it in, you can see that in V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. So you're finding the ST segment elevations that are there. So it's an anterior wall MI. Once you're in the anterior wall, you know it is the left anterior descending artery that's there. So you have to know whether it is proximal or it is distal. So you look at the inferior walls. So inferior walls, you're finding that there is 2, 3 and AVF, there is ST segment depression. So it's not the distal, it is proximal. Next, you look at the AVR. Is there ST segment elevation? You're finding ST segment elevation in AVR? No, there's no ST segment elevation in AVR. So it is not proximal occlusion. So it's somewhere in the mid there. You can take out. So that's what you see there. And if there is an RBBB, it's not very clear here. Not very clear. I think this interpretation is wrong. Here, if you see, you find that there is ST segment elevation in 1, defining ST segment elevation in AVL also. So we are looking at the lateral wall. So this is the lateral wall. You can see that there are reciprocal changes in 2-3 AVF. So predominantly we're looking at a lateral wall MI. It's a high lateral MI because 1 and AVL is only showing the changes. Okay. Finding ST segment elevation in 2-3 and AVF. 2-3 and AVF. 2 is more than 3. And if you see the V1, V2, what you're finding is the horizontal ST segment depression. You're finding horizontal ST segment depressions that is there, and that is suggestive of a posterior wall MI. So this is posterior wall MI, that's what we are finding. So I think any more questions or anything can be asked at this point. Otherwise, we'll continue with the ECGs. Any questions or clarifications? Okay. Other than localizing the MI, what else does ECG help us? One is the localizing of the MI. One is to predict the complications. Predict the complications based on what complications can ensue. You could have a tachyarrhythmia, you could have a bradyarrhythmia, and we told about AVR, AVR ST segment elevation and the mortality percentage. So we can prognosticate the patient. Also, there are complications of MI that could occur. Other than arrhythmia, you could have pericarditis, you can have LE aneurysm that can happen. All those things can be diagnosed on a ECG. So ECG helps in many ways in MI, not only in diagnosis, not only in classification, it can help us in stratification, risk stratification that could be there. Also, it could help us to showing the progression. What stage of MI? Is it an acute stage? Is it a hyperacute stage? Is it an evolved phase? Response to intervention. Moment you're done a procedure, you're done a thrombolysis, the ST should come down. If you've done a percutaneous angiography, the things should resolve. Also the complications, be it the electrical complications or the non-electrical complications. ECG has a very, very important role to play in the diagnosis of all this in MI. Before I conclude on this session, just remember that all these ST segment elevations or T-wave inversions or Q-waves can be seen in other conditions. Okay, so it's not necessary every ST segment elevation is MI. You could get it in pericarditis. Pericarditis, you'll have ST segment elevation in all the leads, but it will not be in a vascular death. Okay. You can get ST segment elevation in V1, V2 in a condition called as Brugada syndrome. You could get Q waves in HOCF. You could get T wave inversions whenever there is ventricular hypertrophy. So all these conditions other than MI, non-MI causes of ST elevation, ST depressions, T wave inversions, Q waves, are what we call it as pseudo infarcts. So you should be aware that there could be other conditions also. But when a patient comes with an acute condition, acute emergency, chest pain is there, dyspnea is there, all those features are there, MI would still be the probable diagnosis that could be there. So, but always remember that you could get changes of ST segment elevations, depressions, T wave inversions, tall T waves, etc., can occur due to other conditions also. So please remember that also. So with that, I think I conclude my session. Any questions or doubts, I'll be happy to take.
Any audience in Zoom can unmute and ask and interact with sir.
Nuclear wall MI with third degree heart block, will there be a wide QRS? Now, whenever you have a complete heart block, when you have a complete heart block, that means the rhythm is going to arise. Infrahis, so you would get a wide QRS. Again, it depends on where the AV node getting blocked. So whether it is above, at, or below. So there could be three types of blocks that could occur there. So if it is occurring at or below the AV node, you will get a wide QRS. If you're having the block above the AV node, you will get a narrow QRS. Depends upon where the block is. That's the answer for that in the chat. Any questions in the other chat?
I think no questions. Audience, if you have any questions, feel free to ask. sir, we have received few compliments from YouTube live chat.
I've answered that in the chat one, which I have answered all. Inferior wall MI with third degree heart block.
Yes, sir.
Q&A section, no question. In the live, there is any questions in the...
Yes, sir. The questions which I have placed in the chat was from live.
Live only. Okay.
Sir, at the initial of the session, I think he pointed out at the respective slide that there is one question that...
I can't see that.
If PR is depressed here, what is the diagnosis, sir? So I think he probably...
PR segment?
Is depressed here. What is the diagnosis?
Okay, so PR segment is basically represents the atria. Okay, so atrial infarctions can be there. So can be elevated. I mean, depressed. In pericarditis, we get PR segment elevations, but in depression of PR segments can be seen with atrial infarctions. Atrial involvement, you can get that. PR segment is for that. Distal LAD, there will be ST elevation in V2 and V4 and inferior leads. How do we infer, whether it's an inferior wall? Yeah. So again, that's what, when you have such a combination of ST segment elevation in anterior as well as inferior leads, you have the differential diagnosis. It could be a extensive anterior wall MI itself, or it could be the wraparound LAD that's there. So it could be the three possibilities. So it's not possible to tell exactly what type of that which of the causes. They'll all be differentials. Whatever you have mentioned it, it is all differentials that could be there. But again, distal LAD, LCX is paired. So reciprocal changes may not be there in the lateral leads that could be there. Whereas an inferior wall MI, you might find reciprocal changes in the lateral leads. But again, remember, inferior wall MI isolated is not associated with anterior wall changes. Anterior wall LAD, that's the wraparound LAD, can be associated with inferior change. So it's anterior wall or it's a wraparound LAD, not inferior wall.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. I think there are no more questions. I have already asked. Please ask if you have any questions.
Okay.
Sir, we got 2000 plus views for this session on YouTube, sir. We will also promote it after our, like after the webinar.
Yeah, I think we'll have a presentation of, I think on the DigiNerve platform, I think there are 8 hours of ECG, that is 8 into, I think almost around 10 hours it will be in total about ECG itself, which I've taken. I think all of you could see that. You will be, that's quite individual things, the basic reading of ECG, the ECG in MI, ECG in electrolytes, ECG in other conditions, everything has been described. So DigiNerve has that platform where everything what is there, both clinical, the theory, as well as these practical things that are there have been described. I think Venu will discuss more about the DigiNerve things that is there. I'll hand it over to Venu. Thank
you. Yes, sir. Before going to the introduction of Venugopal, sir, I would like to say Shreyas to give a vote of thanks to Archit, sir.
Yeah, sir. Wow, sir. I have become a big fan of your teaching. So thank you so much, sir. It was super amazing and very insightful session. Thank you for making ECG in MI so simple and crisp by those beautiful flowcharts, diagrams, clinical correlations, and whatnot, which is required for us to know, which made our concepts really crystal clear. So after this session, I'm pretty sure it is just a cakewalk for us. And thank you, sir, again for taking out your precious time and enlightening us with your precious word on those much prevalent and silent killer clinical vignette, that is MI.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor, for a very informative and wonderfully presented session. So thanks a lot for giving a gist about the DigiNerve. So It's my pleasure that I'll be continuing after your session. Shreyas, you want to do something or straight away can I start with the DigiNow presentation?
Yes, sir. Shreyas will give you an introduction about you.
Sure. So, Mr. Venugopal, welcome to the session and warm greetings to you. So, Mr. Venugopal is currently the regional head business development responsible for sales and marketing of DigiNow online contents in southern region. Prior to his new position, he has spearheading the JP Sprint division as director of the southern region. Core competency in sales of marketing, he has got many years of experience, that is more than 25 years of experience in publishing industry. Particularly with JP Medical Publishers, he has developed a niche in the publishing industry. So, sir, we are so happy to have you over here. And yeah, I'm pretty sure you will be enlightening us with our JP and DigiNow publications.
Oh, very nice. Thanks a lot for a wonderful introduction, Shreyas. And thanks, Tarun and team. You know, it is very, very honor and a pleasure for us to use your platform. And Shreyas, can I use now the screen share option?
Yeah, sure, sir.
Yeah, fine. So, friends, it's a really indeed a great honor and a privilege to present the DigiNow. What is DigiNow and who are we? So what are we going to give it? All those things. As Professor Dr. Archit has given a very small introduction, and after such a wonderful session, I think you all are now so much connected and hello, am I audible, Shreyas?
Yes, sir, you are. We lost you in between.
But okay, because I don't know. There is some network issue was there. I'm sorry. So, friends, so let me take you through to the DigiNow session. And today, I'm going to talk about who are we? What are we going to give it? And so what is our main purpose in DigiNow and how we are going to deliver it? So this is already, Shreyas has talked about DigiNow. DigiNow is an online content provider, and we serve our all online content through app-based learning. So these apps, it is available in the form of Android or iOS applications, which you can download it for your any gadget, be it mobile tabs, and you can start using it. So before I take you through into the DigiNow session, who are we? So that is something you may be having some curiosity. So let me just tell you, DigiNow is a EdTech initiative. It's been taken by, this has been initiative has been developed by JP Brothers Medical Publishers Private Limited, and JP Brothers, we are the largest health science publishers of the globe. We stand today second largest in terms of medical publications. And our aim here in DigiNow, we wanted to serve, we wanted to give it to the student community a high quality content with the concept building approach. And whereas they can develop their clinical skills, they can crack their exams, be it the prof exams or the postgraduate entrance exams, any exams they can crack freely and confidently. So that is our main purpose and motto behind in this. And with whom we are going to deliver it? You know, JP Brothers, we have such an authoritative text, and most of our courses, you will find it and you are going to get through from our the authors. if some reason we have not selected the authors, then obviously you are going to get it from the top class faculties of the country. And as I said, these are the content. It is all the video based content. Anywhere, anytime you can watch it. So that is the advantage for you. So let me just take you to the JP Brothers. As you all know that you are reading B2B, Tripathi, Harshamohan, Shambhulingam, GK Pal, R. Datta, Kurana, SRB, Archit Bolo. You know, there are number of titles. R. Apurva Shankar Shastri, Microbiology. You name it, any best-selling title that is today JP has. And the books that is being read, not only in the domestic, country inside, these books are being equally, it is being read outside the world also. So we have such a largest presence now globally. And the company, it started in the year 1969. And we have totally now spent 52 years in the service of medical publications. And during this 52 years, we have produced 4,000 medical books and dedicated to only health science. So there are about 60 plus journals you will find, 2,500 plus video procedures that is there in our JPD content. We are available on digital platform too. And the latest one is the DigiNow, where the lecture class being delivered. And apart from this, yearly, we are going to add something like 350 minimum new titles. So that is something that speaks about the volume JP is increasing year after year. So this is something about the achievements and the accomplishments what JP has since from its inception. You will see that year 2020, we launched the DigiNow. So that is the latest one. And what are we going to give it in the DigiNow? As you all know that medical courses are available. There are final proof for all the five subjects courses are ready. Second proof micro is ready. And many more are in the pipeline. So like pharmacology, community medicine. So that will be launched by us very, very soon, including the pathology. And there is nursing cracking for the exams, PSC cracking exams. So that is also, it's almost ready. Very soon it is going to be on air. So you are going to get even the nursing cracking exams also. And our goals, as I mentioned, that all these content we provide through the expert and reliable knowledges. So our books are mainly it is being based. And through the best faculties, we are going to deliver it to you the lectures. So that is something you can always dependable on us. So this is our vision. And our mission is something like we are going to provide it all these things on such a friendly and student-friendly technological platform, which you can use it anywhere. Like while traveling also, you can just plug it and hear it. And while taking a rest also, you can just plug it and hear the lecture class. And apart from that, we are giving many other important features, which I am going to talk about, which I am going to talk in my further presentations today. So as we have talked enough about the faculties and the contents, that is something you always depended on the JP Brothers publication, which we can boldly say that you please keep continue with that. And rest is assured, the best content that we are going to provide you. And it is all based on the new CBME curriculum that talks about the conceptual studies and the same methodology we have followed here. So concept-based medical education is the new curriculum or new syllabi that has been prescribed by the NMC, and we follow the same syllabi in our lecture class. And these are the lecture class. It is meant for One is for your additional knowledge, and the second is, of course, for your prof exams, and also equally very, very useful for your NEET PG entrance exams too. And all these are, it is being served on a such a best platform, and the technology, you just log in and start accessing the trial access content and you will feel it. It's all served on a, such a latest and the best technology, rest assured, I can say that. So as I have told you that what we are presently serving, the final pro for all the five main subjects, B2B medicine, surgery, OBG, pediatrics, orthopedics, and the second pro of microbiology, these are ready and it is there on air. You can anytime attempt for the trial access. Currently, we are feeding 10 days of trial free access. So the whole content, it is available on a free trial access mode. Apart from that, we have a very interesting professional courses too. Like there is a basics of infertility and IUI. That is also, we have launched almost 6 months back. And we have ultrasound in OG. So this is another very interesting professional courses. And for the exam prep courses, we have a cracking MRCP. So this is again by Dr. Archit Bolur and others. I would like to suggest you, please try it out and just log in and have a look at it, how valuable contents are given and how worth it is it. So please try this. And going into the stream, like the courses, we have talked about the microbiology. In the courses inside, what are we are going to deliver it? So obviously it is video-based lecture classes. There are about 150 hours of video lecture classes you are going to find in microbiology, and 81 lecture notes that has been made out of these 150 lecture classes. These lecture notes that is being presented in completely formatted, fully loaded with all the features like tables, charts, boxes, clinical images, handmade illustration, anything to everything. What are all the additional ingredients or students, they are looking at it from their perspective, everything it has been loaded. And as you know that there are about 81 topics that has been prescribed by the NMC for the new microbiology, which has seen a vast of improvement. And now it is called clinical microbiology, which has been studied like a system-based approach. But you're going to find something like a problem-solving approach, the way we have presented, it's a first of its kind. No other online platform or a content provider, they are serving this as of now. So we proudly say that we are the only first online content provider who are feeding these kind of the contents, where you get a lecture class along with the practical exercises too. And all these, present this? This is none other than the very popular Dr. Apoorva Shankar Shastri. Dr. Shastri, you know, he has five popular books in his kitty, and the best-selling one is his third edition, Essentials of Medical Microbiology. Sir is from Pondicherry Institute of Medical Sciences, is an additional professor over there. And ma'am is, she's from Pondicherry Institute of Medical Sciences. She's also additional professor over there, Dr. Sandhya Bhatt. And third faculty is Dr. Deepashri. She's assistant professor at JSS Medical College, Mysore. So these are the top three faculties they have joined, and they have given this micro content. Orthopedics, here we are going to serve you about 50 hours of video lecture classes, and made out of 51 topics. So you will find the same 51 topics of notes materials, and there are about 1200 plus MCQs and a good number of clinical case scenarios. I can say that each and every lecture class, it begins with the clinical case scenarios. That is the approach it is being given. And not alone this, you will find the instrument, x-rays, diagnostic and therapeutic skill procedures. All these are, it has been discussed and it has been given in this orthopedics video based lecture classes. So this is being brought to you by Dr. Vivek Pandey. He's the faculty over there through DigiNow. And Dr. Vivek Pandey, he hails from Manipal. He's associated with the KMC Mahé University. So he's the additional professor over there. And sir has written two titles, two of his books, two JP publications. And one is being very popular among the postgraduate musculoskeletal examination. Other one is meant for the paramedical courses, Essentials of Orthopedics. Continuing with the same courses, we have OBG. And here we are talking about total about 80 hours of video lectures. And this is something like you're going to get it 100 plus the notes, all these lecture classes. It's been presented in the form of notes too, as I said. And there are about 2,500 MCQs that is being given. And the interesting part over here is the labor process. We have given the complete labor process demonstration with the help of a dummy demonstration that has been given. So that is something like a very, very, I can say that interesting feature of this particular lecture class. And here you will find the five faculties and the key faculty being Dr. K. Srinivas. He is associate professor from Bangalore Medical College, Bangalore, a premier institution from Karnataka. And sir is attached to this particular institution. He has a very vast teaching experience. He has written quite a few articles and one full-fledged PNR book. So apart from that, he is known for his teaching skills. And continuing with the same course for the final prof, we have a medicine for undergrads. That is none other than by Dr. Archit Balur. Dr. Archit, he hails from Mangalore, attached to KMC Mangalore. And sir has given this medicine video lecture class in the form of there are about 110 topics he has covered and 110 hours of video lecture classes you will find in this particular course. And apart from that, there are about 2,500 MCQs that is being given. And also you will find a good number of review questions in the each and every topics. At the end of the topic, you will find minimum review questions that has been loaded at the end of the topics. So that is the same style. You will find it in most of the courses. And continuing with the pediatrics, this is being brought to you by two top faculties from pediatrics, Dr. Santosh Sons and Professor Saundarya, both from Mangalore. Dr. Santosh, he is attached to AJ Institute of Medical Sciences, past IAP president and current chief of pediatric intensive care division. Dr. Saundarya, she is associate professor at KMC Mangalore, and they have joined together and they have brought out this pediatric course. Here you will find about 74 hours of video lecture class, and this has been given in 73 notes. You are going to get it for the 74 hours of video lecture classes, 1200 plus MCQs that has been provided with that lecture class. And this is also, it is available currently for the free trial access. Please try it out, make use of it. Lastly, very recently added surgery. So this has been brought to you by Dr. Sriram Bhatt. Professor is head of the department of KMC Mangalore, Department of Surgery. And he has more than six titles in his kitty. And there are a few of the titles. So very popular, like I would like to name one is SRB's Manual of Surgery, which is doing pretty good. Sir has written books not only for UGs, even for the PGs, nursing and dental. So that goes and that speaks about the volumes. And his writing still, it is, I can say that it has been appreciated and acknowledged by one and all. Here in the surgery lecture class, sir has given 220 hours of video lectures and made out of 161 topics. So there are about 2,500 plus MCQs he has given, and he has given a detailed discussion about the instrument X-rays. Apart from that, there is clinical examination and DD. So that is also he has discussed in detail. So all these things, you are going to find it in three verticals. So like general surgery, we have split, and general surgery section, you will find some of the topics. Systemic surgery, we have divided. So there also you will find some of the topics. And the clinical surgery, again, specialty and clinical surgery, it is going to be of the most interested and awaited topic, I can say. So these three, I can say that the verticals, you will get 220 hours. And currently it is available on a 10 free days of free trial access. So all these are, it is available in DigiNow. Please try it out. And for any of your query and concerns, you can reach out to your nearest Team JP executives. We are there and we are happy to serve you and happy to address any of your queries and concerns. As I said, it is available in the iOS and Android applications. Please download it today. It's very simple. Type DigiNerve, go to Play Store and start downloading it. So that's it from the Team DigiNow. So our main motto is we wanted to see that we wanted to make each and every the student professional, we want to see them as a top doctor bane wahi jiska guide ho sahi. So this is our slogan, and please download today, start using the trial access of DigiNow courses and contents. Before I sign off, I would like to extend my sincere thanks to Tarun Kumar, thanks to Simhachalam, thanks to Team SMR and Team MedInvade 2021 for providing this opportunity, a wonderful opportunity and excellent platform to showcase and talk about a few things about the DigiNow contents. I sincerely hope whatever I have shared, it is of your interest, and definitely you will start using the trial access and do inform us about your feedbacks and other reviews. Thanks a lot. So over to Shreyas. Now it is to you.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm just shocked and amazed by this initiative which is done by JP to make sure that medical students are benefited in all aspects considering this pandemic and all the things. So such a wonderful initiative. I, after this session, I'm gonna see this author's video and take benefit of it. And surely I hope that all our delegates also take benefit of it, because you are providing all the things that too from our comforts of home. So thank you so much, DigiNow team. And thank you so much, Chit sir, for enlightening us for this session, ECG, with ECG for MI. We are so thankful and grateful to JP team for starting the series under MedInvade 2021. And we are looking forward to next.
It's a Seymour here. Pleasure to be really associated with you. And as I said before we sign off, I look forward to hear from you, because this is the session we have made it like an interactive one. If any of the student are interested delegates, they have some queries, questions, so they can please throw throw to us, and we are happy to address the same. So Shreyas, please, if anything is there, do let us know. So.